reading vlog on Bloodlines. When I first read this, I didn't really read it because I didn't know who anybody was. I didn't know who Sydney was. I didn't know what an alchemist was. I had just been introduced to Adrian because I didn't finish the Vampire Academy series. I stopped at Shadow Kiss because Dimitri was turned Strigoi and I didn't want to continue reading after that. It would have been, well, I thought that I wouldn't have liked the series if I kept reading, so I stopped. But then I started reading this one and I got some spoilers about the rest of the Vampire Academy series. One being that Rose and Adrian have a relationship, that not only did Dimitri get restored, but Sonya did as well. So after I read this book, I went back and finished the Vampire Academy series, and I loved it. Now, here I am, rereading Bloodlines. I think it was wrong of Sydney to assume just because she now has a new perspective on what the alchemists do, to assume that Zoe wouldn't want that lifestyle just because she now doesn't want it for herself. Now knowing what I know, I can understand why Keith would have preferred Zoe because of how inexperienced she was. But tell me, out of the entire alchemist network, there is only one family with two teen girls, as their dad said. You could only pick between the two. When Keith and Sydney get to Palm Springs and they get to Clarence's house, his reaction when Adrian opens the door, is that all genuine or is some of it fake, like a facade he put on for Sydney to make it seem like he was more afraid than he was? Because I refuse to believe that Keith was this afraid of Amaroy and he was getting injections of blood from Clarence. I mean, yeah, Clarence is an older guy, but he's still Amaroy. And we're also at the point where Sydney and Adrian first officially meet. And when I first read this series, the whole series, their relationship came out of the blue for me, like, and their feelings for each other. It was completely out of the blue because she's an alchemist, a human girl, which she says this multiple times throughout this book alone, but neither of their races are okay with Moroi and humans having relationships other than the humans being feeders. So it really came out of nowhere. Once Sydney starts talking to Jill, she asks her, like, what did happen? Why do you need protecting, basically? First, why didn't they want the alchemist, or at least the two that would be there with them, why didn't they want them to know what really happened? And also, I really wish at some point we got like a small flashback to when it happened, because I just think that would have been really interesting. When Sydney is talking to Rose about this law, getting this law changed so that Lyssa doesn't need a family member to stay in power, so that Jill is out of danger, it occurred to me that throughout all of their time in Palm Springs, it seems like way more than 3 months, because that's how long Rose tells her it'll take, about 3 months. It seems like it takes much longer than that, because by the last book, they're like a week away from the law being passed, when in the first book, they're 3 months. But again, it seems like a lot more time has passed. Exactly how big are we supposed to imagine that Clarence's house is? because throughout the rest of the series, I imagine like this small one story house with maybe like 3 rooms at the most, and maybe a big kitchen. But Sydney says, we drove the half hour to Clarence's estate in the hills. So how big is this house? When it comes to Keith, and even knowing what goes on in re-education, like what happens there, I don't feel bad for him at all. Because why would you say, well, he's not the one the alchemists are going to come after and send to re-education for playing around with vampires when she should be disciplining them? All of these vampires are you and Sydney's age and older. How is she going to discipline grown people? An alchemist's job is not to discipline them. It's essentially to clean up after them. With Jill and Adrian's bond, since it was obvious that nobody involved was gonna tell Sydney about the bond, Jill could have been less inconspicuous, like saying things that you shouldn't know, talking about conversations that didn't happen in your presence, like when Lee, Adrian, and Sydney were talking about Jill and dating. Like, you were not part of that conversation, but yet you still can't even ponder the reasoning behind is when Sydney drove Adrian around to all those interviews because he didn't want a job, but he needed money, so he needed a job. Is that he was purposely sabotaging these interviews. But why? Why not just tell her when she gave you the list of jobs? Why not just tell her right then, oh, none of these is gonna work for me. We need to figure something else out. But instead, you had her go around to all these places just for you to bomb the interviews. Jill. Everything about Jill just upsets me. But right now, I'm talking about when she just left and went off with Lee. Why would you do that? You knew the very first thing they would think when they couldn't find you or get a hold of you is that some Moror group found you, kidnapped you, or at the very least say, get rid of the queen or we'll kill her sister. Something like that. You knew that would happen, yet you went away without telling anybody. She could have at the very least told Adrian. And even when Adrian found out, and I'm pretty sure his feelings were strong enough for her to feel it. So you can feel how worried at the very least Adrian is. Yet you still walk back in the dorm all smiling, laughing, as if nothing happened. And then, to add to that, the very next morning, she wants to bring up this modeling thing. And this right here is why Adrian fell in love with Sydney. I didn't pick up on it the first time, because remember I told you I didn't think they would be together. But Sydney even says it herself. It struck her odd how easily everybody always covering for Adrian and making excuses for him or just brushing him off or he's Adrian, stuff like that, and saying he can't help it, it's how he is. Well, Sydney refused to believe that. She actually made strides to show him that he can be more. He became more. Reading through this the first time, I found it odd how the only thing we got about Keith's, I guess, arrest, the only thing we got was him catching the alchemist raiding his apartment, basically. Well, finding his stash of blood and saliva. only thing we got was, oh, Mr. Darnell, we were hoping you could come in and answer some questions. Like, okay, I guess. I mean, I know it's like assumed that, and after that, he went to re-education, but I would like a little more. In Keith's apartment, when Lee has both Sydney and Adrian, like, I guess like holding them hostage, if he was thinking clearly, he would have realized that it was not a good idea to have Adrian there if he wanted to go through with his plans, because, oh, I completely forgot, Lee doesn't know about the bond. I think I just understood why they didn't want the alchemist to know now. Okay, about Maroy relationships, Eddie said that Maroy and Dompier relationships aren't any serious relationships between Maroy and Dompier's. Why can't there be? There totally could be. There totally could be. And also, it was said earlier in the book that Dompier's can create Dompier's with Dompier's. Why? How does a Maroy and a Dompier create a Dompier, but a Dompier and a Dompier, nothing. That's all I have for Bloodlines. But if you enjoyed this video, come back next week where I will be reading The Golden Lily.